of us, mostly writers and artists, went down to the border, and our idea was to witness what was happening there. So the first place that we stopped was at the court in Tucson. We came to an immense new building, not quite brutalist architecture, area. It was built especially for processing immigrants. We're going to witness a judicial proceeding called streamlining. Watch 70 immigrants be deported in 90 minutes. We waited and waited in the hallways. The spectator seats are full. We have all to take turns, but nobody was exiting. Let's go down to floor 2. Maybe we can watch initial processing. A guard said, "A lot of bleeding hearts here today." Waited, waited on floor 2. There was a lit up board like at the airport with names of people and their attorneys and judges. Some lines labeled flip-flop. Nobody could tell me what flip-flop means. Went back up to floor 6. I entered and took a seat in back. A row of about 10 men shuffled in. They were shackled hands and feet. Earbuds for hearing translators. Mostly short men, brown skin, black hair. A Latino man seated on the outside of the railing turned around and looked at us, looked at me. I nodded and looked away, but caught his nod back. Behind the shackled men, 3 or 4 lawyers, maybe public defenders, would remove an earbud and talk privately into a man's ear. The judge, a pretty Caucasian blonde woman, asked a series of questions. All of the accused must answer yes to all of the questions. Yes is the correct answer. The court recommends yes. I remember 3 of the questions. Are you an alien? Alien to the United States of America? C. Yes. C. C. Yes. 10 C's and yeses. For detention of 105 days with credit for time served, do you agree to waive the right to a trial by jury? Yes. C. Etc. Has no one forced you to plead guilty or made any promises to you other than what we've talked about here in this court? C. Yes, etc. My naivete is bottomless. I'm aghast that rights are like gaming chips. You're given so many chips, time, credits, jury trial, and you can trade them. And you swear that you were not coerced or pressured to play by these rules. The group of shackled men shuffled out, and a new group shuffled in. But this time, there was a difference. A man answered no. No to waiving trial by jury. The judge asked him the question again, and asked if he understood it. A lawyer took out the man's earbud and spoke to him, told him the consequences of no. The judge was giving him a chance to change his mind. He said again, no. The court finished the streamlining. Shuffling out of the courtroom, many of the men kept their heads turned toward us spectators. I felt their eyes say, "Help." Next, we went to an amphitheater-like room, like a lecture hall, a classroom. A judge spoke from a table in front. Like every public official we met, he commended the state's treatment of illegal immigrants as humane. Operation Streamline is as humane as possible. Out of 1,000 people caught at the border, only 70 are put on trial and imprisoned. The rest are turned back. People with children are turned back. Those arrested are seen by the Mexican consulate and given advice. The judge was very tired, a large, heavy, coughing man. He held what looked like a plastic, unlit cigarette that he put in his mouth and take out again. His other hand opened a matchbook, but he did not light it. Earl said, "He's going to die soon." Jessica Hagedorn said, "He's Shakespearean. He's tragic. I like him." The judge suffered our group's questioning of him. One of the radical Latino guys asked whether the judge, a Mexican-American, was going against himself, betraying yourself and his own people. The judge gave his story, beginning with his grandfather's immigration. His family was fortunate. Grandparents, parents, himself, all fortunate. His grandfather fortunate to have come when the crossing was easier. The family made money. All crossing was easier. They got educations, served in wars. He himself in Vietnam, he'd been a public defender. "Not Mexican American," he said. "Not this American, that American, but American." He heaved himself up from weariness to the eloquence of the orating trial lawyer, barely coughing. One of us observed that one of the streamlined men had grass in his hair. Are they disoriented and wounded coming out of the desert into court? The judge said, "I can't criticize a man's grooming habits, but they do come straight from the desert to the courtroom. They do not come straight from the desert to the courtroom. They are checked medically. They get fed. They get water, a place to sleep. Their consulate speaks to them. The lawyers speak to them. There are translators. At least 2 days of preparation before they come into the courtroom." Jessica Hagedorn asked after the man who pleaded no, "What's going to happen to him?" The judge said, "He's basically screwed. He screwed himself. He could have gotten away with 105 days in detention camp. Now he's going to get 2 to 5 years." The judge said, "There's no way he will be found innocent." A judge said that. The judge prejudged. He already knows the man is guilty. He will get 2 to 5. Patiently educating us, he reviewed the process. The Border Patrol picks up a group of immigrants and sorts them out. You with the kids, you go back. You who've been seen entering the country without documents, you go to court. At court, you're offered a plea bargain. You can plead guilty to a misdemeanor, a small thing, not having papers. That man who pleaded no will be charged with a felony. Illegal immigration. No way will he be found innocent. The Border Patrol witnessed him committing that crime. He broke the law the moment he stepped across the border. Crime migration, say the activists who made up that word for criminalizing the attempt to cross the border. And the judge started speaking, and it sounded more personal. How open and free and efficient the crossing is when we want something. We transport wild turkeys and gray wolves and money and tomatoes, vegetables. His cigarette hand moved back and forth, indicating many things and creatures passing back and forth. But we can't find a way to transport people. We want gray wolves, we transport gray wolves. We can't transport people. So we went on and we went across the border back and forth at Sasebo and Nogales, and we went to refugios. Some people went to the morgue, but I didn't want to do that. I didn't think I could take it. And what we brought, our witnesses witnessing, and everybody was political, and I felt that there was another level to this, especially since I'm writing a diary. I can write down things that are supernatural or superstitious, and so I heard about this. Making the crossing, hundreds of migrants have had to. Okay, this first draft. Making the crossing, hundreds of migrants have had appeared to them. A man who brings water and food, and sometimes money. Lately, he's been known to drive a pickup truck and give rides. He points out the direction the immigrants should continue traveling and where to find shelter and even a job. When you've made good in El Norte, he tells them, come back south and give thanks at Santa Ana de Guadalupe in Jalisco. People who've completed that pilgrimage were surprised to find a picture of that very man they met in the desert. He's Father Toribio Romo, shot to death in the Cristero War, 1928. On the back of holy cards, there's a prayer. Prayer for migrants. It's from the point of view of the people left behind. We ask through the intercession of Santo Toribio Romo for the caring and protecting of our family who have had to leave the house. Protect them from all evil and that they remain firm in faith so they can soon return to our home. Strengthened in the soul and body. So I brought to the border holy cards of Father Toribio Romo, and I brought medals, and I found at the CVS store holy candles for St. Romo, and I brought those, and I distributed them at the border and on the other side, and at this as a political story or event. It's also a spiritual journey. And so I am wearing a St. Toribio Romo medal right now because there's talk going around that that birthright citizenship will also be denied. And so that would include me. And so I'm wearing my medal just to see whether we can stop that. On this trip, I also met a woman whose name is Dream, and that goes with the dream